I'm grateful today to have someone that I consider to be a friend. Yes, we don't get a chance to talk all the time. We don't wear each other's patience then. But I tell you this much, when we see each other, we're so excited to see one another. And we totally enjoy, truly, truly enjoy the fellowship that God has given to us. And I've never asked Pastor Prisco this, but I can only share from Elder Smith's heart how I feel. I can't hang with everybody. I always do that way. Matter of fact, I specialize in getting you to tell me what's going on in your life, and I won't tell you nothing about mine. But when God takes time out to handpick your friends, that's a beautiful thing. And I sense in my heart, in the spirit realm, he's probably a lot like me. I've watched him navigate, probably an appropriate word, and how he works with his congregation, and I would just have nothing but much love and respect for him. And before I bring him, I knew you were an anointed man of God to be able to pastor someone like Sister Edwards. Lord, have mercy. She wouldn't rest until we met, Pastor. And I'm so glad she never gave up when you and I coming together. So without further ado, congregation, we present to you one of the finest preachers I know, my friend and my brother, Pastor Prisco. Let's receive that next time. Hands together, give God a praise. Come on, bless the name of the Lord. Tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. Turn around and tell somebody, I thank him because he's been good. Tell him I give him praise because he's been merciful. Tell him I love him. Hallelujah. Oh, summer. Glory to God. Somebody steal the atmosphere around you. Oh, my God. Cause everything around you to move in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Somebody tell him thank you. Tell him thank you. Oh, bless the name of our God. Hallelujah. Ooh, Shama. He's here. He's here. He's here. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. You may have your seat. That time I said, the levels. Oh, my soul. Yes to your will, yes to your plan, yes to your purpose. Say yes! Say yes! Yeah. Glory to God. I'm out of time. I'm trying to tell your neighbor before you have a seat. Tell him, neighbor, I want you to know that everything is already all right. Tell him God already fixed it. All you got to do is receive it. Receive it. Believe it. Oh, I feel him in here. Oh, bless his name. Hallelujah. I'm trying to wait till my sister get out of the flow before we move, but I might have to move while she in the flow. Hallelujah. Ain't nothing wrong with the flow. Sometimes we need a flow ministry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may have your seats. Amen. We bless the name of the Lord. Amen. God is good. Amen. We certainly honor the Spirit of Christ who's first in our lives. Amen. And certainly to Pastor Smith. Amen. God bless him. Amen. I like him. With everybody. Amen. I don't dislike people. I'm not a mean person. I just don't hit it off with everybody. Amen. And those I don't hit it off with, I don't worry about it. I just move on. Amen. But I thank God for Pastor Smith. I love his spirit. Amen. His wife. Amen. Evangelist Smith. Amen. God bless her. We thank God for her and her sweet spirit and the fellowship we had when we came down and they came down to Cambridge. God knows, y'all got a preaching pastor. I can hear him preach anytime. Amen. We thank God for him. Also to my wife, Lady Briscoe. Y'all don't mind. I'm gonna just change just a little bit, just shift a little bit if you don't mind. Amen. We want to have Sister Fred, and she will come and minister us in song. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. He worthy. Amen. To be praised. Amen. And we bless his name on tonight, on today. Amen. God bless you. Amen. It's good to be here. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. To bless the Lord with the people of God. Amen. There is such an anointing in this place. The atmosphere is set. Amen. I'm going to, I heard what Pastor Smith said about me being a holiness preacher. Amen. And I heard the comment he made. Amen. And I could make the same comment to him. Amen. If you can't be blessed sitting under Pastor Smith, you will never be blessed. Hallelujah. I believe that God has chosen us to do different things, but pastors have the ability to move in different avenues of life and in ministry as God has instructed them. Some are anointed in other places, in other facets of ministry. Amen. That some aren't as anointed as much to move in that facet of ministry. Amen. And I believe that Pastor Smith is anointed to move in the ministry of prosperity and to be blessed. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. Say, neighbor. I'm going to be blessed in this season. Amen. I'm going to be blessed in this season. My plan is not to hold you long, but to break unto you the bread of life. Amen. My plan is to be blessed during this season. I don't plan. Amen. I plan to go ahead, go further, go up, however you want to put it. Amen. I plan to do the will of God and not be lack in this season. Amen. God didn't call us for lack in this season. It is time for us to have more than enough. Amen. If you would turn your Bibles to the book of Isaiah. Amen. Not going to be long. Isaiah 55 and 11. Amen. Isaiah 55 and 11. Amen. When you have it, say amen. All right. Amen. Isaiah 55 and 11. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I sent it. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. I was hearing Pastor talk, and he was talking about how we have to shift or move into our place. The song that the brother was singing, talking about being blessed or moving or shifting into the place where God wants us to be. But a lot of times, he was talking about control. He was talking about order. Amen. And order brings an increase. How many know order brings increase? Amen. But a lot of times, we as the body of Christ, and I saw as the people leaped and rejoiced off of the fact that order brings increase. And when he made the statement, increase, everybody received. But you can't receive the increase until you get the order. Because order brings the increase. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter 5 and 10, it says, but the God of all grace, who have called you unto his eternal glory by Jesus Christ, after that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. There is a process that the church has to go through, that the body of Christ needs to go through to receive from God what God really wants us to have. How many know it's time out for us to be living beneath our privilege? It's time for us to be blessed and highly favored above measure. I believe that. It's time, if there ever was time, it's time now for us to shift the tide of our lives and to shift into the place where God wants us to go. For a few days now, I've been hearing God said it's time to take a shift. And a lot of times we get stuck in a tradition and stuck in things and stuck in the way that we do things. And a lot of times we get locked in so that God cannot move and be glorified in our lives the way he wants to be. We get locked in into a way of doing things and a way of receiving things until God cannot move for us like the way he wants to, because when God moves out of what we perceive to be right or perceive to be his will, we rebuke God and we pray for the enemy. Because we're locked into a place where we won't allow God to have free course in our lives. It's time now for the Christian, for the believer, to shift into the place where God wants us. I was preaching out last night and I had the opportunity to preach, and I was going to preach this, but in the middle of my message, God shifted my message to, where is the church that Jesus built? And I said, Lord, I thought this was the message for that church, but obviously that wasn't the message, so this is the message for this church. So just look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's time to shift. I believe that because God wants us to be the head and not the tail, he wants us to be above and not beneath, he wants us to be lenders and not borrowers, that we have to shift into the destiny that God wants us to have. Lord, have mercy. I believe this thing. We've got to shift to inquire, to get the place, to get in the place where God wants us to be. You can't go get on 95 and go north and end up in Florida. You will never end up in Florida on 95 going north. There's got to be an exit, a U-turn. There's got to be something if you're going to reach your destination. If you're going to reach the place where God wants you, you got to make a U-turn and go the direction that God, that you need to go to get to Florida. Lord have mercy. So the scripture tells us that we need to decree a thing. Decree means to give an official order with the power issued by the rule of the person with the authority. How many know sometimes you got to give an order? You got to tell situations. You got to demand situations. You got to speak to situations. You got to give an order. You got to set things in order. Sometimes in our lives we fail to set things in order so that increase cannot happen. Amen. Can I take this?
Yes, sir.
The Bible says the definition of decree means to give an official order with the power issued by the rule of a person with the authority. Mm-hmm. We mean simply to just issue a decree. Speak something. Meaning to speak it with authority given to us by God himself, to bring about an already established a change that should be taking place in your life. Now when we speak the word of God and the will of God for our lives, we're not speaking something that we made up. We're not speaking something that we just thought up. But we're actually speaking what God has already ordained to be right in our lives. The Bible says we have not because we ask not. So when we begin to ask according to the will of God and the purpose of God, we're really asking in his divine order. We're asking his divine will that it would be established in our lives. How many want the divine will of God established in your lives? When we speak the word of God, which is already established in heaven, then we enforce it through a verbal agreement. Through a verbal communication. We're not speaking stuff out of the atmosphere, but we're speaking the will, the purpose, and the plan of God.
for our lives. Amen. Let me believe that.
Yes, sir.
Our words become the bridge that links us between the blessings of God in heaven and the things that we're operating down here. How many know we need a bridge? We got to be able to speak those things which are in heaven and bring them down to the earth realm. The Bible declares that whatsoever you bind in heaven on earth shall be, whatever you bind on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth shall be bound in heaven. We need to release the word of God, and the only way that we can release the word of God is we've got to speak it. We've got to proclaim it. Isn't that right? We got to announce it publicly and pronounce it so that the enemy can hear you speak the word of God. You have to speak in order to announce something. You just don't speak, but you got to speak in order to announce something. And we must announce to our circumstance and to whatever the enemy has around us, we have to announce to it that it's not going to work. It's not going to accomplish what it's trying to do. Because the Bible lets us know that the will of God is going to be accomplished in our lives no matter what the enemy says and no matter what he does. For the scripture I read in 1 Peter said, but the God of all grace who have called us. There's a call upon our lives. He didn't call us just to be in church, just to be a part of church, but he called us to be saved, sanctified, and he called us to be prosperous.
Come on now.
He called us to be blessed. And he called us to be highly favored. One thing I'm tired of, Pastor, is folk going around talking about I'm highly favored, and they really aren't.
That's right. Come on now. Yes, sir. Say it now.
I believe that the church needs to come to a place in God that when we speak, I'm highly favored, we really are highly favored.
Hallelujah.
Isn't that right?
That's all right.
We've got to speak the word of God. We've got to decree it. We got to proclaim the word of God. We got to announce it to the forces of the enemy that the enemy knows that we are what God says we are. God's word has to have preeminence in our lives. God's word has to have preeminence. Nothing else can take the place of the word of God. Nothing else can take the place of the spoken word of God, because when God's word has preeminence, it shoves us, pushes us, shifts us into a place of blessing, to a place of increase, to a place of divine power, to a place where God wants to have the right to bless us and to move in our lives. We must declare the word of God with the fear, for the Bible declared that the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent must take it by force. We can't just pity-pat the word of God, but we must declare it with a fierceness. We must declare it out loud and with a boldness that I am the blessed of the Lord, that I am blessed and highly favored, and no matter what the enemy is trying to do, it cannot work, because I am the blessed of the Lord. We must declare it with a fierceness. We must declare it with a force. We must declare it like a bulldog watches over its owner. We've got to stand upon the word, and we can't let the enemy make us believe that God is not going to accomplish what his word has already spoken. Lord have mercy. I feel like preaching in here. The word fierceness. Lord have mercy, gets our attention. The word fierceness lets us know that there's a violence there. There's an aggressiveness there. There's an anger there. In other words, when I speak the word fierceness, I'm just not saying I'm blessed and highly favored, but I'm letting the enemy know that no matter what the circumstance I'm going through, no matter what I'm up against, I'm still blessed and highly favored. God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody say, yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
when we declare the life. And you know what? That's one thing that we, the church, need to start doing. We need to declare over our loved ones. We need to declare salvation over their lives. I don't mean just a Mickey Mouse prayer and the Lord gonna save you and pray for you, but we ought to get violent and begin to declare that you are saved. Declare it, for the Bible said, isn't that right? The Bible said he will save your whole house. Isn't that right? So we got to declare it like the Bible said and stand upon it. Isn't that right? Lord have mercy. We can't declare it today and stop declaring it tomorrow. We can't speak it today and not speak it tomorrow. You may ask, well, how many times or how long should I declare the word of God? How long should I speak the blessings of God over my life? How long should I declare his will, his purpose over my life? The answer is, you ought to declare it until you see the manifestation of what you declare to come to pass. You ought to decree it until you see God move on the behalf of your loved ones. You ought to decree it until you see souls saved and delivered and yokes broken of the lives of your loved ones. You shouldn't decree it today and stop tomorrow, but touch your neighbor, say, neighbor, decree the word, declare the word, and proclaim it.
Hallelujah.
A few moments. I'm almost finished. Decreeing, proclaiming, or declaring, it's not something that we just pick up. It ain't something that we just do for a little while or do for a little bit, but we do it until we see the manifestation of the will of God happen in our lives. The reason why we're facing such a high divorce rate in our churches, and we're facing such high things that's going on in our churches and disorder in our churches, is because the people of God have lost the power to decree some things. And when we lose power to decree some things, the enemy comes in and he takes a seat in our congregation, takes a seat in our homes, takes a seat on our jobs, and he takes over and takes authority. But how many know the devil has no power? He has no authority. When the man of God, the woman of God, begin to decree a thing, stuff had to happen. Touch a neighbor's name. Things have to happen. Hey, your name is Haven. See, take a seat. Tell them something gotta happen. Something got to happen. When we decree the will and the purpose of God, something has got to happen. There is no way you can walk around decreeing the will of God and nothing happens. When we decree it and mean it, when we speak it by faith, something has to happen. A shift take place. That's why the enemy holds up our prayer sometimes. It's not because God is not going to do it. A lot of times because the enemy knows that if I can hold it up just 1 month, if I hold it up 2 months, I know that after a while you'll stop praying for it, you'll stop decreeing it, you'll stop believing. So the enemy gets in and just holds it up. That's why sometimes when you get into prayer, you go through your house and you begin to speak salvation, you begin to speak deliverance. That's why things get worse, because the devil says, if I can just stop her, if I can just stop him from declaring the word, I know that it will not happen. But you got to be like a bulldog. You got to tell the devil, devil, you are alive. I will declare the word. Declare it until I feel the manifestation of it happen in my life. I will declare it until I feel salvation. I will declare it until I see deliverance happen in my loved one's life. I will declare it until I see my financial state change. I will declare it until my health change. I will declare the word of God. In the Bible said, I'm the Lord thy God that healeth thee. So I'm not going to walk around sick. I'm going to declare that I'm already healed. Even with a limp, I'm going to declare that I'm already healed. We got to call those things that are not, even as though they were. Isn't that right? In a circumstance, you got to look at it, and you got to let the enemy know. known that you cannot win in this circumstance, that I'm more than a conqueror in this circumstance, that I shall be blessed and highly favored in this circumstance. If you ever wake up one morning and you're faced with a hard trial and you're faced with some problems, grab a word of God, grab hold the word that fits your problem, that fits your situation, and quote it, and keep on quoting it, and keep on speaking it, and keep on saying it, until the enemy gets the news that this thing, it won't destroy me. Touch your name and say, neighbor, I know that's right. Have your seats, have your seats. Never be dismayed or discouraged when you are decreeing something. Don't be dismayed or discouraged because the feeling is not there, because the passion is not there. We're not decreeing something because of a feeling. We're not speaking because of a passion. There's some mornings I wake up, I don't feel saved. There's some mornings I wake up, I don't feel sanctified, but I know I am because the word says I am. Some things I decree, I haven't seen it yet happen, but I know the word says I'm blessed and highly favored. So in the midst of this, I won't get dismayed, I won't get in a dilemma, I won't discouraged, but I'll decree the word of God in spite of my feelings. I'll decree his word in spite of my feelings. I'll speak his word. Isn't that all right? I will speak the word of God. The biggest job, the biggest task, or the biggest trick of the enemy is to make us feel like God isn't going to do what he said. Lord, I feel like preaching that. The biggest task of the enemy, a trick of the enemy, is to make us feel that God is going to open the doors like he said, that God is going to move like he said. But how many know if God said it, he's got to do it? The Bible said God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Whatever God says, it's got to come to pass. Isn't that all right? We cannot afford to buy into the lie that it ain't going to happen, that God ain't going to move, that my loved ones aren't going to be saved, that my loved ones aren't going to be delivered. We can't buy into it. It's just a trick of the enemy. Our help, mercy. Hallelujah. It's not possible for God's word to not accomplish what he sent it out to do. For God's word has inherent power. Power that reproduces itself. Power that reproduces itself. When you're weak, that's when the power of God stands up in you and fortifies you and strengthens you. That's when the power of God stands up in you and makes you stronger for the task ahead. That's why the devil don't want us to get into the word of God. He don't want the word to get in us. For the Bible declares, if my word abide in you and you in my word, ask what you will and I shall do it unto thee. How many know it's right? We cannot afford to slow up now, nor to slack up now, but we got to move. We got to shift to the next level. So many of us been riding in first gear, trying to get up 50 miles an hour, but you can't get to 50 miles an hour in first gear. You got to shift to second gear. You got to shift to third gear. You got to shift to fourth gear. And when you want to do some serious driving, you got to shift to fifth gear. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, shift with leadership. Shift with your pastor. Don't care how it seems. What he's speaking may not seem impossible. May not seem impossible. What he's speaking may seem like we can't get that done. But if he said let's do it, then let's shift to it. Let's get it done. Isn't that right? Because if he said it, God's going to give him the wisdom, the knowledge to get it done. Isn't that right? Lord have mercy. The word of God on his own power has an inherent power that keep on reproducing itself in you. That's why the enemy don't want you to hear the word. That's why they don't want you to hear the word to take root in you. Because when he knows the word has taken root in your being, you will come up against a test and you'll look at that trial, that test, and you'll begin to speak the word over that test. When you speak the word over something, you literally release the power of God in that situation. When you speak the word over something, you literally release the ability of God to get done what you can't do. When you speak the word over something, you literally release the ability of God to accomplish the things that yourself can't do. Isn't that right? So we have to keep on speaking and declaring the word of God. Remember, God, word does not return unto him void. But the scripture says he watches over his word. He's watching his word. He may not be watching your moans. He may not be watching your groans. He may not be watching your complaints. But he's watching over his word to perform it. So that's why the church has got to have the ability to speak the word of God. Hallelujah. Touch the neighbor's name. Speak the word. Speak the word. We got to have the ability to speak the word of God. Give me a minute. The ability to speak the word of God. Because he said, my word cannot return unto me void. His word cannot return unto him void. Pastor said it means whatever I speak from the word of God, it's already accomplished in the spirit realm. I'm not trying to make something happen that hasn't already happened. See, I want you to know something, that God, he's not a God that dwells in our time. He's beyond time. He created time for us, but God is beyond time. For the Bible declared that 1,000 days, 1,000 years is as one day, and one day as 1,000 years. So God is not dwelling in time, but he moves in time for us. But he don't move in our time. He moves on his time. So the scripture says, he said, God's word cannot return unto him void. When we speak the word of God, he watches over his word to perform it. He watches over his word to make his word come to pass. And you may say, well, Pastor, I've been praying and believing God for something for a long time, but does it line up with the word of God? What you pray, what you believe in God for, does it line up with the will of God, with the word of God? Because if it does, you can set a note on it, set a sticker on it, you can seal it and take it to the bank, that it's going to happen. If it's God's will, if it's God's word, it's got to happen, because he watches over his word to perform it. The Amplified Version says, so my word, so shall my word be that goeth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void without producing any effects. In other words, when I speak the word of God, it's got to produce some effect. It's got to do what it said it would do. It's got to happen like you said it would happen. It's got to deliver like you said it would deliver. It's got to make a way like you you said you would make a way. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, speak the word. Speak the word. We're living in a day and time where folk are speaking all kinds of things, all kinds of negative things. But it's time for the church, the body of Christ, to speak the word. It's not enough just to pray a little bit. It's not enough just to ask a little bit. But we ought to go behind what we can do. Go behind how we feel and speak the word. Go behind what the enemy says and speak the word. Touch your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh neighbor, speak the word. Lord have mercy. Speak the word. And without it will produce. It's got to produce. It cannot come back useless. It cannot come back without any effect. It cannot come back void. When I speak the word, I've got to look for my blessing. When I speak the word, I've got to look for my increase. When I speak the word, I've got to look for the outcome to be favorable unto me, because his word cannot return unto him void. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, speak the word. When we speak the word, when we speak the word, Jeremiah 1 and 12 says, then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen, for I will hasten my word to perform it. What you mean, preacher? When I hear my word, when I hear my word coming back to me, I will hasten to perform my word. I will hasten to bring deliverance. I will hasten to open up doors. I will hasten to make a way. I will hasten to save souls. I will hasten to break yokes. I will hasten to set the captives free. I hasten to perform my word. I move quick. The word of power, the word is power. It's not based upon your feelings, not based upon your thinking, not based upon how you do, but it's based upon his word. Whatever he said, he's going to make it happen. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, say, oh neighbor, but he shall, but it shall accomplish what I sent it out to do. Enough notes here. But it shall accomplish what I sent it out to do. What you mean, preacher? I mean my word. The word of God, it's got to accomplish what he sent it out to do. Whatever he said, it's got to accomplish. Whatever he speaks, it's got to happen. However he moves, there's got to be deliverance. Isn't that all right? It shall accomplish what I set it out to do. It can't come back unto me void. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, it will accomplish. It's got to accomplish. It's got to accomplish. I ain't got no believers. I ain't got no help. It will accomplish. It's got to accomplish what God set it out to do. It can't come back wrong. It can't come back empty. It can't come back useless. But it's got to have a binding effect, a strong effect. It's got to move in the spirit realm. I may not feel it, but if I keep on speaking it, I may not feel it, but if I keep on declaring it, I may not feel it, but if I keep on decreeing it, it's got to happen. For his word, it cannot return unto him. Though his word cannot return unto him. destroyed the curse. His word, it brought me out. His word, it touched me. His word, it delivered me. His word, set me free. His word, made me a new creature. So that the things that I used to do, I don't do no more. It's all because of His word. If His word saved me, if His word delivered me, then why should I still be bound? I still have the word. It still has power. It still has authority. It still has the ability to do what it did before. If it saved you, it'll save your loved ones. If it made a way for you. Some folk today, they feel like the word of God has enough power to save, but not to bring us out. It has enough power to save us, but don't have the power to deliver. I don't have the power to break the curse of the enemy. Got enough power that if anything to save me and deliver me from myself. I ain't talking about from my enemies. Because you gotta understand that your worst enemy is not the person that's on the outside. But your worst enemy is yourself. We believe that the word of God has enough power to save us, but don't have enough power to deliver us. Well, I got news for somebody today that if that same word, if it really saved you, if it really made you who you say you are, if it really made you a new creature, if it really made you a new individual, then that same word has enough power to deliver you and to break the yoke. Same power has got that same word, has enough power to save my loved ones, to keep me from falling. That same power and the same word has enough power to change my course, to shift me into a new dimension, to shift me into a new place, to shift me into a new walk, to shift into a new place with God. That same word has enough power to move on my family. That same word has enough power to keep me from falling and to present me. We want the salvation, but we don't want the power that it brings. I tell you, I'm a homeless preacher. We want the word, but we don't want the keeping power that it brings. We don't want the deliverance that the word it really brings. So since we don't want that the living word, the living power that the word brings, we still bound, saved, not married, but bound. Bound because you want somebody. Bound because you'll take anybody. Just as long as it's somebody. Lord have mercy. That same power has enough power. And because we don't want that power, the married is looking for somebody else. The married is looking for somebody else because we got the word but don't want the power. But I submit unto you today that that same word that touched you, that same word that kept you, is the same power that'll keep you from falling, that'll cause want you to present your bodies a living sacrifice unto God. It's just your reasonable service. You need the power of God. We need the power of God. Not just a word, but a word with power. A word with authority. A word which shifts us. To shift you, it ought to cause you to go the right direction, because flesh has the tendency to catch you and put you on the wrong track, have you going after the wrong thing. But when I come to church and I hear the word, I leave now with more power, power to shift. Of God, shift according to his will, shift. Let the enemy know that yes, I got messed up, I got sidetracked, but I heard the word, and the word, it got in me, and the word started working in me. Gotta be like Jeremiah. Jeremiah said, and his word was like fire shut up in my bones. The word of God was so powerful, he couldn't hold his peace. Jeremiah said, I wouldn't preach anymore. I wouldn't declare anymore. Have you ever said, I ain't coming to church no more. I'm tired of church. I want to do what I want to do. But the word that was in your bones wouldn't let you stay. You try to stay home. You try not to praise him. I'ma come to church, but I ain't gonna praise him. I'ma come to church, I'm gonna sit in the back. But the word was in my bones. It shifted me. It changed my mind. It changed my heart. It shifted me. It moved me. It caused me to do the will of God. It caused me to walk upright. It caused me to turn right. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, you need the word to shift you. It shifts us. Too many preachers, too many leaders are speaking now motivational messages with no power to get to heaven. No power to get to heaven. Just power to accomplish some stuff down here and get some stuff down here. And God knows I want some stuff while I'm down here. But I also want the ability, the strength, the wisdom to know that stuff is going to pass away. Things are going to fail. Houses, they get old. Cars, they tear up. Clothes get too small sometimes. Isn't that right? But I know that if I've got the power of the word, I know that no matter what the enemy comes in with, no weapon that's formed against me shall prosper, because I've got the word. I can shift in any direction when I got the word. I can walk in a dark, perverse generation, undefiled, holy and clean, because of the word of God. Want me to tell you what the word us. Come here, somebody.
Yes.
I need a little perfume. Now you come here, come here, Marquette. Come here quickly.
Yeah.
The word of God has the ability, has the strength. Because sometimes when we end this race, sometimes we fall down.
Yeah.
We fall down.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But the word,
the
power of the word,
yeah.
We fall down.
Yeah.
But the word,
yeah.
We fall down. Yeah. Yeah. When we fall down. Y'all say, you ever hear the devil calling? You know that thing you used to do? You know? And he'll tell you, come on. You know that place you used to go? And you'll just ride by it? And you hear the devil say, come on in. Come on. Just come in. Maybe you can witness to somebody. You can help somebody. Because Jesus sat among them. So you might have to go sit among them too. So you know how the devil here works. But the power of God. See, you can't do it by yourself. But the power of the word. You ain't got to work it. The power of the word will begin to work in you. It'll work. The devil said, come on, come on. But there's something on the inside. You hear something say, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord. Reprove them. You keep on driving. Then you go past another place and you hear the enemy saying, come on, come on, man. Just say hello. You ain't got to stay. Just tell her you will stop and die just to say hello. Ain't no bad feeling. You know he speak to you. Oh, come on, y'all.
Yeah.
He'll speak to you.
Uh-huh.
See, one thing about the church, we think that because we're saved, we don't go through nothing. But that's why you've got the power of the word. Because when you want to say yes and to surrender and give in, the word of God refuses to quit on your behalf. We are determined to do it, but God has a determination also. And Pastor Smith, his determination is to bring you to the place where you ought to be. It don't matter how many times that he's got to shift you, but he's determined to bring you to the place where wants you to be. He's determined to shift you and to bring you to your destiny, your place where he can use you for his glory. His word will not return unto him void. So it's going to stay here. It's going to work here. How does it stay? It stays in the form of the Holy Ghost. Am I talking right? He said, if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. So the power of the Holy Ghost is enough power to cause me to move in my right direction where the Lord is taking me. Somebody touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm ready. I'm ready to shift into destiny. I'm ready like never before. My mind's made up. I'm ready to shift into God's purpose, into God's will. I'm ready to take the city. I'm ready to take the community. I'm ready to take my families. I'm ready to take my loved ones. Status quo. Are you satisfied with what you're doing? Somebody said, if I tell you, neighbor,